Hey, good morning, church. Can you believe it? I'm wearing pants in August. What is up with that? Isn't that amazing? Thank you, Jesus. This is so different than a year ago. A year ago, you would have all been coming in here. Man, this is amazing, isn't it? It's my favorite time of the week, too. We get to hang out together. And you're saying, well, I have to hang out with you because you have a microphone, so... So we're going to hang out for the next couple hours here, and let's stand this morning, and let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for just another opportunity to get into the Word together. We know that that's just the foundation, that's the bedrock of our lives, and Father, I pray that today, if there's anybody here that does not yet know the love of you and your Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit, pray that today would be the day of salvation. So we thank you, we praise you, we honor you this morning in Jesus' name. Everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Hey, so I want to start this morning by saying thank you for just being such a generous body of Christ. You guys never cease to amaze us with all the donations to the food pantry, and we always have enough food to hand out every single week. Never does anybody come to that door and ask us for food and get turned away empty-handed. And so I just want to say thank you, guys. And also just a reminder that the first weekend of every month, you guys are invited to bring down food items and drop them off in the black boxes that we have in either lobby. And those usually just get overflowing by the end of service. We have guys take them down to the basement and sort them, and then so we can get ready for this next service to be able to just fill those boxes up once again. And so we have lots of dried noodles, so we're good on those. So if you guys have more stuff like soups and stew and that kind of stuff, peanut butter, that kind of stuff, we would love a lot more of that. So thank you for being generous. It's amazing. It's just an awesome testimony of how grateful you guys are to be a part of the body of Christ, but also just the love of Jesus poured out in our community in such a practical way. So thank you for doing that. Also, the next thing I get to talk about is Financial Peace University. This class is coming back around again. Pastor Jason Moak takes us through once a year. It's a couple weeks in a row going through step by step how to leave financial chaos in the rearview mirror and get right with your finances. So if that's you, if you're behind on bills, if you've got debt coming out your ears and eyeballs, this is an amazing class. It transformed my life and my wife's life. About a year ago, we went through this, and it's just an amazing, it's a way to freedom, financial freedom, using money God's way. And if you've tried to use money your own way, you know what I'm talking about when I say, how's that going for you? So, Financial Peace University, see the website for more information. Also, guys, the website's got all the information you need to know about what's going on here at Mountain. So that's mtnchurch.tv. And also look us up on Facebook, and we'll invite you into that group. And it's just an awesome community. You guys are amazing in raising your hand saying, I need help moving, or I need help doing this, or whatever. And it never ceases to amaze us how everybody just jumps in and helps. So get in that Facebook group and be a part of that community as well. So with that, we're going to take 2 minutes this morning, and I want you to focus on saying good morning and hi to only one new person that you don't know, and ask them what they're doing after service this morning. So we're going to take 2 minutes and say hi to each other. Ready, set, go.
Good morning, church. Make your way back to your seats. We're going to praise. We're going to worship this morning. My name is Tom. If you weren't here last week, I am a new staff member here at Mountain Church. I'm happy to be with you guys. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you meet us here, that you love us. You love to give your mercy out, and your mercy is new every single morning. So God, we just sing of your amazing grace, and we give you all the glory and the honor. And everyone said, amen. The power, who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. shakes? Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Let's sing it out. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my crown. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for you've done for me. Who brings our chaos? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. With truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. This you would take my place.
Of Christ, and we're just amazed, Lord, that we can stand here boldly in your presence, Lord, knowing that our sin is forgiven, that you look at us, Lord, through the lens of Christ. You look at us in perfection, and our sin has been cast as far as the east from the west. So we just give you praise and we honor you. We desire, Lord, to worship you. It's what we were created to do. Everything was made by you and for your pleasure. And so, Lord, we desire to please you and just acknowledging your greatness and our need for you. And we do that in a variety of ways in our life, in the songs that we sing and in our giving and generosity and our time when we come to the table, time we open your word, just our life is an act of worship. And so you be honored, you be blessed as we just continue to worship you here this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You guys can have a seat. And we're going to continue to worship the Lord here. That's what we're here to do this morning. And we're going to worship now as an act of just honoring the Lord in our giving. And in recent months, we've had the giving time at the same time as the time that we've come to the table. And I just had a little check in my heart about that. Just, I don't want to ever take away from the body and the blood of Christ. And so it's just kind of been stirring in my heart. One of the things the Lord's been speaking to me in recent weeks. And just to always keep the body and the blood of Christ the centerpiece of who we are. And the fact that we've been forgiven and that that is a free gift. And I never want that to be confused with anything. And so we're separating that time of worship for this season. And we're going to take this opportunity right now to give. And so the brothers are going to come, or the brothers, maybe sisters too, are going to come and just pass the baskets for us to take that opportunity just to give unto the Lord. And so we're going to do that now as just an act of worship, not out of obligation. If you're new here, we just ask you, please just let the basket go by. This is something that we do as a family, and as an act of worship to the Lord. You say, Lord, I trust you, and I love my family, and I love you, and I want to give. So the brothers, you guys can pass those here in a moment as we just continue to worship the Lord this morning.
At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh. We love to shout your name, O Lord. At your name, the morning breaks in glory. At your name, creation sings your story. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. Sing the chorus again, Lord of all the earth, Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise. Endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. sing, there is no one. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. There's no one like our God. We will sing, we will sing. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, praise you. No one like our God. We will sing. Let's lift our voices, church. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord. We sing, Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, O Lord.
One of my favorite, most thrilling seasons of life for me over the years is seeing people come to faith in Christ and get baptized. And we do that regularly around here. I was officiating a wedding last night, and a brother there came to me, and he said, "Hey, Jim, me and my wife, we're a part of Mountain Church, and we're not here all the time. We kind of travel around, but I really want to get baptized." And I kind of looked over at the Rogue River that was right there, and I said, "Well, we can do that right now if you want to." And he goes, "No, not right now. But I'd really like to get baptized." And baptism is this great, beautiful outward expression of what God has done in our hearts. And you guys, you know, get that opportunity to witness and maybe be a part of that over the years. And this last Easter, there was a young gal that had gotten baptized, and I could just tell, man, there was just something really special going on in her heart in that moment. Didn't know what, but in time, Maureen invited her out with some other people out to our place, and kind of heard her story. And so I was like, "You got to share that story with the rest of us." So if you guys would welcome Cassie Waterman. Cassie, you guys can sit down. And Cassie, if you could just, she's totally petrified right now. She's like freaked out that she's going to do. But remember, you got 3 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, that's what he tells me at least. This thing so. On, can you hear me? All right. So, I kind of wanted to start with, I don't think I would have believed my own story like 6 months ago. I was abused my whole life, like my whole childhood. And when I finally heard that my parents were getting divorced, I was like, yes, like I'm so excited. Like not that, you know, 11 years old, you shouldn't be super stoked about something like that. But I was excited because the person that was hurting me was gonna be leaving. And fast forward to being 18 and realizing, oh, that wasn't normal. Not everybody was, you know, getting beat as a child. Like, oh, okay. So I fell into this like super big depression and a lot of anxiety. I got kicked out. I lost all my soccer scholarships, tore my ACL, things like that. I fell into this deep depression. I was living in my car. I fell into drugs. I fell into alcohol. I fell into just really anything I could to kind of numb myself. And then a few years later, I fell into a really toxic relationship. And that was just something where I was either going to kill myself or I was going to get out. And I had this friend that I kept badgering about church. And I finally was like, 4 years ago, I actually came here. I sat right there. Every time I come here, I sit right there. And 4 years ago, I used that as an excuse to kind of I want to leave you. You're not on the same path as me. And I just had no idea what I was doing. And little did I know, God was like, you'll be back. You'll be back in 4 years. And January, I actually came back. Sat there a couple times, and I was high every time I came. And I didn't really realize that was something wrong. And I remember sitting there, and something that Jim said just spoke to my heart, and I was just like, he's like, you know, we got pastors to pray for you. And I was like, fine, whatever. I don't know what to do. I'm just going to let him do it. Went over to this weird guy named Chris Campbell. I don't know. He was sitting there, and I was like, I don't get it. Why are they raising their hands? What is going on? Why don't I feel like this? I don't understand. Like, just yelling at him. And I was like, I'm not yelling at you. I'm yelling at me and everything else, and just not understanding why everything was just, like, so amazing for these people around me. And I was just devastated. And he's like, he kind of, like, sat there and listened to me just yell at him. And he goes, he's like, huh, I've been there. Like, we've been there. And I'm like, yeah, right, whatever. And he's like, oh, I'm going to introduce you to my friend Maureen. I was like, who's Maureen? And he's like, oh, it's a pastor's wife. I was like, oh, great. This lady's going to make me go back to church and all this stuff. And so I ignored her actually a couple times and rescheduled lunch and didn't want to go out with her. And I finally went out with her, and it was amazing. And I cried. She doesn't do that to many people, but, you know. She invited me to this women's group, didn't want to go to the women's group. Went to the women's group, and she put me on the spot. Again, doesn't do that. And I was bawling my eyes out the first time I was there, and got invited to this women's retreat, and didn't want to go on the retreat. Finally went on the retreat. First time in 8 years I hadn't actually been high. And that God was like, whoop, I'm coming in. Like, I'm getting your heart, and I am not letting you go. And I was saved that weekend. That was this April. And I ended up having this whole family of women that I just had never, I was like, oh, when I went to the women's group, I thought I was going to be super judged, and they just took me in. And then I was baptized on Easter, and I quit my job, and I quit smoking, and I quit a band I was in, and I quit, like, so many things. And I remember hearing Pastor Ryan talk about, if you know God and your life has not changed, then you do not know God. And I looked over at my new boss. I was sitting right there. I looked over at my new boss, and I was like, oh, my gosh, I feel like me. Like, oh, my gosh, this is so crazy. And now I'm up here, and I'm talking about it. And I went from that seat to not knowing why anybody raised their hands to raising my hands in praise and, like, knowing God and loving him so much. And Mountain Church is a huge part of that, is a huge part of why I even feel like that, because they didn't make me feel like an outcast. They just loved me. And so I just want to say thank you to Mountain Church for that. And of course, all glory to God. But I just, and now, and I'm gonna share a song actually that means a lot to my heart. And it talks about scars and who, you know, how it brought me to where I am. And I wouldn't be who I am without these scars. So thank you.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade it for anything, 'cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know tell of who you are. So forever wouldn't trade it for anything.
Never underestimate the power of love. It's the love of God that has drawn us to repentance. Not rules, not regulations, not condemnation, not guilt. It's the kindness of God that draws us in. And grace and kindness can do more than the law ever, ever could. And that's why we are through and through in the scriptures taught that the mark of the church, the mark of the disciple of Jesus, is love. And it's repeated again and again and again and again all through scripture to love. And once again today in 1 John chapter 3, as we continue in our study through the word, we see this theme once again. So take your Bibles, if you would, and open up your Bible apps, perhaps on one of your devices, and turn to 1 John chapter 3. And it's this repetition, which, by the way, repetition is the key to learning. And so God knows that. He knows us. He created us. He knows our necessity for repetition in our life. And as we continue to go through something again and again and again, at some point along that journey, it becomes a part of us. And that's God's heart for us, is that this, the love of God would become a part of us, not just a theology, not just an understanding, not just something that we can repeat and say, yeah, love is really important, but it becomes part of who we are. And so this old man now, John, this apostle of Jesus, is now refining his message down to this simple bedrock of who is Christ and who are we to be. And it boils down to that four-letter word, love. Love. And it's something that we need to hear. Again, I don't care how long you've been walking with the Lord. I don't care how old you may be or young you may be. I don't know how many times you've taught this, how many times you've read these things. At the end of the day, we have not arrived. We must continue to press in to learning what love looks like, which means knowing Him, knowing the source of love. And in 1 John chapter 3, verse 11, we pick up where we left off before. And John would say this, I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. I cross-reference a variety of other translations. If you need a Bible, by the way, just lift your hand. Somebody's ready to run one down to you, so lift your hand real high. If you need a Bible, turn to 1 John chapter 3. And in verse 11, it says this. John says, this is the message that you've heard from the beginning. He said that before. And it's this, we should love one another. It's like, man, that's all I ever hear about, seems like, recently. Well, that's what the word keeps saying. And so there's a reason for that. Because there is no greater human achievement. There is nothing greater that you or I could do with our life. No matter who we are, there's nothing greater than knowing God and knowing the love of God. It's the highest human achievement. And when we know Him, we become like Him and we begin to love others. Jesus taught this. He lived it. The disciple of Jesus strives for this. The church of Jesus is defined by it. Mountain Church is known by it, which, by the way, is the greatest possible reputation a church could ever have in a community, is that they love one another and they love the community that they're a part of. And this is the message that's been heard, John would say, from the very beginning. In other words, God created in love. We talked about this. Adam and Eve were loved. Everything that God has ever done, he's done it in love. It's nothing new. Throughout the millennia, in ancient writings, the poems have been written about this topic of love. Art has been created. Songs have been created depicting this topic for thousands of years. It's nothing new. It is really the golden rule kind of burned in the DNA of humanity, that we are to do unto others as we would have them do unto us. In other words, love. It's nothing new. In verse 12, John would go on and he would say this: we must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. And why did he kill him? Because Cain had been doing what was evil and his brother had been doing what was righteous. And so the apostle John continues in his quest to teach the importance of love in the life of the believer, and he shifts gears and he uses a negative example. He said, it's so important that we love. It's nothing new. Oh, that we would love one another. And then he uses this negative example and saying, whatever you do, don't love like this guy. How'd you like to be that? That would be your, you know, your claim to fame in the Word of God, you know? Like, oh yeah, Cain, that guy. Don't love like him. Adam and Eve's children, Cain and Abel. And everybody knew the story of Cain and Abel. Maybe you know the story of Cain and Abel. And it's been written about and known throughout all kinds of circles throughout the years, not just within the context of the church. You meet very few children named Cain. And so the story is pretty popular, and it was even in that day, and by oral tradition, parents had been teaching their children about Cain and Abel for centuries and centuries and centuries. And so everybody knew the story, and when the apostle John says, don't be like Cain, everybody's like, yeah, no kidding. And Cain was a man who allowed bitterness to turn him into a murderer. And Cain and Abel were called by God to sacrifice, to worship. And Cain brought some leftover vegetables. But Abel, he brought a sacrifice. He brought that which required life and death. He brought a blood sacrifice. And after Abel brought the first fruits of what God had given him, the first fruits of his flock, the first fruits of what God had given him, he said, Lord, this is yours. And it requires blood. It hurts. But Lord, I'm giving this to you. And it was a picture, of course, of Christ who would once come and give his life for us. And Cain became jealous because Abel's sacrifice was accepted by God, but Cain's was not. And so Cain became bitter and he became angry. And he started holding this animosity towards his brother. And he let it boil within him. And it raised up this bitterness within him, and he began to become more and more angry. And at some point, eventually, with this jealousy and harbored anger and hatred within his heart, it eventually turned into murder. And Cain would kill Abel. And it says here in this text that Cain was doing that which was evil, but his brother had been doing that which was righteous. And evil will always hate righteousness. Always. This is why we are told throughout the scriptures that we're not to be surprised when the world hates us. Don't be surprised. The world hated him, they're going to hate you too. In other words, the worldly system, the evil system of the world, that it will hate righteousness, always has, always will, like oil and water, they will never come together. Evil and righteousness cannot coexist. And this is why the disciple of Jesus cannot continue to live in sin and at the same time live in righteousness. The disciple of Jesus will respond to the Holy Spirit and repent and receive forgiveness in time in his journey. But he cannot continuously continue to live in a world of sin, whatever that might be. And mostly that's hidden behind the scenes. But a Christian cannot. It's impossible. It's oil and water. Righteousness and evil do not coexist. And so, in the story of the life of the disciple of Christ, at least this is my experience and what I see theologically, is that you and I, as disciples of Jesus, we're traveling through life and we fall into a pit. Maybe we jump into the pit. Either way, along the journey of life, we love Christ, our lives have been changed, we now are living a life of love, we want to live in righteousness, but along the journey, we don't live in perfection. We're contained to these bodies of flesh, and we're always subject to the failures of life. And yes, sin has no power. It doesn't have dominion in our life. We're not a slave to it, but we still will choose periodically along the journey to do stupid stuff. Am I alone in this? I don't think so. I think we're all on that track, right? But I can't continue in that sin. There's that sin, that failure, that smart aleck comment that tore somebody down, that sexual impropriety, that whatever it may be. But then there's the conviction. Oh, man. That was wrong. I know it's wrong. Your word is clear that I was totally not considering others better than myself. And your word says that I'm to consider others better than myself. And I know that to be true because that's what you've done, Christ. And so I totally failed in that. I'm just letting my really soft stuff out of the bag here. The hardcore stuff is like, man, I have just absolutely failed in my thought life with a lustful thought, whatever it might be. You know, Lord, I have just failed. And there's this conviction in the heart. And that conviction is by the Holy Spirit. And by the way, that's really good. I used to think that conviction was this really bad thing because I was always convicted about everything, it seemed like, you know. And I still am. But conviction, what it does, it's beautiful. It drives us to Jesus. So conviction's really good. When I'm convicted about sin in my life, it's like, Lord, thank you that you haven't just left me to my own devices, but you've, by your Spirit, convicted me, and that conviction drives me to repentance. It's like, oh, Lord, change me. I know I'm forgiven, but Lord, I come to you and confess that. And Lord, I want to be strengthened. I don't want to live in that world. I know that's destruction. I've proven that. I've driven my life off that cliff so many times. No, Lord, I'm not going down that road, and I apologize. I repent. I know I'm forgiven. Thank you for your forgiveness, which is, by the way, the beauty of the table. That's why Jesus says, come to the table as often as you eat and drink, which is all the time for all of us. Come and receive that forgiveness. And bask in that truth that you're in good standing with the Lord. And so there's the sin, there's the conviction, there's the repentance, and then there's the restoration. And that is a cyclical journey in the life of the believer. We'll all go through that journey. We all have gone through that journey as disciples of Jesus. There's the sin, the conviction, the repentance, and the restoration. And then there's the sin and the conviction and the repentance and the restoration, and then the sin, and then, you know, and there's, it's a cycle of life, and it's periodic. And as we mature, hopefully those, there's you know, more time between that cycle. And that's the life of the disciple. But for the life of the unbeliever, the person that doesn't know Christ, there's the sin. And then there's feeling bad about it, because sin always makes us feel guilty. Sin weighs on every person, on every man, Christian or not. There's a weight. There's a realization of failure. There's a realization of separation from God. There's a knowledge of that within, it's in the DNA of mankind. And so there's the sin, and then there's the, well, I feel bad about it, but I'm unrepentant. In other words, it is what it is. I'm just going to continue in that world, because I got no better options. I'm just going to continue in it. And then they end up in that unrepentant state, just living in that sin day after month after year. And that person is not a disciple of Christ. There needs to be in that individual a regeneration of the spirit, a regeneration of life, being born again, so that when the sin happens, there is a conviction and there is a repentance. And there's a healthy relationship with God. And so John goes on and says, so don't be surprised, dear brothers, if the world hates you. Don't be surprised. Back to the evil and righteous understanding that there's no way that the two of those can mix. And he says, don't be surprised. When you see the world system that's full of greed and evil, hating on believers, don't be shocked. When you read articles in your news feeds on how Christians are being perhaps persecuted, don't be surprised. Shouldn't be shocking. When you hear about students that are being harassed or injured because they're taking a stand for righteousness concerning what God's word says, don't be surprised. It's not shocking. Shouldn't be. When Christians are being hated on, don't be surprised. In the classroom, at the workplace. But to be clear, if the Christian is being hated on, may it be because of righteousness. May it be because of rightness, not hatred, not superiority, not obnoxious living, not greed and self-centered behavior, not a lack of compassion and pride in a person's life. If I'm going to be hated on, may it be because of rightness and truth, not because I have taken a stance on a particular topic and I've hated on a particular people group or whatever. May it be for rightness, always tempered in love. And if the church is hated for righteousness and love, then so be it. But may it never be said that we are hated on because we simply don't care about humanity. We don't care about the environment that we live in. We don't care about refugees, or we don't care about immigrants, or we don't care about the homeless, or we don't care about one another. May it never be said that we are hated on because we don't care. May we be hated on because we're Christ-like. And I pray that when we are hated on, it's for his sake, that we're hated on for love's sake, for kindness' sake, for mercy's sake, for the sake of truth. And then verse 14, John would go on, he would say, if we love our Christian brothers and sisters, it proves, check this out, if we love Christian brothers and sisters, if we love each other, right here, right now, if we love the Christian community that we're a part of, right here, with all the different shapes and sizes and socioeconomic, you know, places that we fall into, whatever tribe, whatever nation, whatever language, the whole, you know, mixed up, stew called the church. We are to love one another, and if we do, it proves that we have passed from death to life. But a person who has no love is still dead. I mean, John just plain doesn't mix words at all. He's saying, if I love, I am alive in Christ. If I don't, I'm dead. To simplify that phrase. There is no way to misunderstand what he's saying. There's no alternate interpretation. This is what he's saying. If we love, it proves that we pass from death to life, and a person who has no love is still dead. In other words, the proof of our salvation is if we love one another. With all of our flaws and all of our foolishness and all of our pride and all of our differences and everything that we are, then and only then can we claim to be a disciple of Christ. And if we don't love, we're still dead in our trespasses and sins. And if we have not been changed into a man or a woman of love, then we have not been saved. If there has not been a radical regeneration of life, if there has not been a radical death to life experience, and we now are bent in the direction of I desire to love. Now, that it's not easy. And this Christian walk is not for sissies. It takes grit. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone and Christ alone. He's done all the work from beginning to end, and our lives are regenerated when we place our faith in Christ. But then we begin our journey, and we're like, now I'm on this track to learn how to love. And that's not easy. Now, I have the power within me to do that, but it's going to require death. It's going to require me along that journey to be a generous giver. It's going to require for me along that journey to be one that serves others. It's going to require for me along that journey to die, just like we've learned what love looks like. It is giving, serving, and dying. And if there is somebody in God's church that I hate or that you hate, a brother or sister that you're like, man, I just cannot stand that person. And because of that, I won't talk to them. I will avoid them at all costs. I will talk trash about them behind their back. If they were in need, I would rejoice instead of helping them. Maybe you disagreed with them somewhere along the way and you got an argument with them and tempers flared and you walked away, but that relationship has never been restored and there's that bitterness, that Cain-like bitterness. And if you are a believer, if I'm a believer in Christ, then shame on me for not being the bigger man and making things right with that individual. Owning my part. Forgiving. See, that's what love looks like. That's not easy. If you are okay or I'm okay with hating on a brother or hating on a sister, then something systemic is wrong with me. Something systemic, something in here is wrong. If I'm claiming to be a disciple of Christ, and I can allow that to continue on in my heart, then something's rotten in there and something needs to change. Either that or I'm just simply dead and I need to come to life. I'm simply dead in my trespasses and sins, and I have no problem with hating on others. Then that is a sign of death. But one thing that John is saying that is absolute, one thing for sure, one thing that is certain, if you or I are a disciple of Jesus, then you or I will love our brothers and sisters and we will make things right as best as possible. And if I have or you have no interest in loving, then you most certainly are not a disciple of Christ. There's just no gray area here. I'd like to make it easier to digest. I'd like to say it a little softer. Actually, I wouldn't. This is really helpful for me. I like it just black or white. No gray area here. And if I look in my soul and say, Lord, do I have a desire to love? And I can answer that question, yeah, I do. Awesome. Then I am a disciple of Jesus. And then generally, with that great comfort comes great conviction. And then here's a couple names, Jim. I want you to work on loving. Oh, yeah, I do. I want to. Yeah, I know you do, Jim, because you're one of my disciples, and that's a trademark of a disciple of Jesus. You want to love. And now what about this guy? Oh, man, I hate that guy. No, Jim, that's the point. That's the whole point. You want to. Now you do it. But he's a jerk, Lord. You know that, you know. Well, Jim, you're a jerk. I know that. And I loved you. And anyone, verse 15, who hates his brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. Oh, okay. And you know that murderers don't have eternal life within them. 1 John 3:15. Anyone who hates is a murderer, and a murderer does not have the love of God in them. They don't have eternal life in them. John is echoing what Jesus taught and lived. If you hate, you're a murderer. Murderers have no life. In verse 16, we know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us. So we ought to give our lives for our brothers and our sisters. Jesus showed us what real love is. At the end of the day, it's death. At the end of the day, it's giving up life, giving up my rights, giving up my way, giving up my self-centric life. So, that brother or that sister, they really offended you. Was Jesus offended? Yeah. And he still gave up his life. That brother or sister, they talked trash behind my back. Totally took what I said and twisted it and lied about it and broadcast it and put it on Facebook and whatever, you know, and just like totally took my legs out from under me with total lies. Yeah, but did people talk trash about Jesus? Yeah. Well, he still died. He still gave up his life. Maybe that person took advantage of your innocence. Was Jesus taken advantage of? Yes. And he still died for us. That person disagreed with your theology. Did people disagree with Jesus? Yeah. And he still gave up his life. That person borrowed money from you and never paid it back. Did people take from Jesus? Yeah. And he still gave up his life. And John is saying through this, listen, Jim, love proactively, and that requires to give up your life. In other words, again, if I could repeat myself, is this Christian discipleship thing is not for sissies. This walking with Jesus thing is not for Christian socialites. This is the real deal. And John is putting meat on this. Being a disciple of Jesus, it requires some real grit. It requires that we plant our feet and say, this is who I am. I'm going to love. And that's going to require some pain. Salvation is a free gift, but man, living a life of love, it costs me everything. And by the way, when we choose that, and you guys know this, you guys have taught me this, is when we do live a life of love, of total death, we can never go back to normal, because that is where we find life. There is no returning. It's like we find, oh, this is what Jesus meant when he said, Jim, you will have life, but only when you give your life up. And when we finally, willfully get into the casket and pull the lid shut and say, I am done with my self-centric, selfish, prideful ways. Lord, I am done. We find resurrection and we find new life. And that's exactly what Christ did. He died. He willingly pulled the door down, the lid down on the casket, so to speak. He willingly went into the grave. But only when there was death, there was resurrection. There had to be death first in order for there to be resurrection. And John is giving you and I the key to what everybody in this world is striving for. Life, peace, rest. And he's saying, here's the key, right here. Just take the key, Jim, and use it. Here's the key. It's, you know, right here. And you take that key and you look at it, and on it, it just says death. Death to self. Okay. I'm going to love. I'm going to give and serve and die. And it is only that path, to a healthy life. It is only that path that leads to peace. There is no other path. Like, okay. And Jesus taught it and he lived it. So verse 17, it will be done. If somebody has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? So John says, if you and I have enough money to live well and we show no passion or compassion for others, and we will not give of our money, and he uses, it's very specific, if someone has enough money but won't give it to those that are in need, and it says, then God's love is not in us. He asks the rhetorical question, well, how can God's love be in that person? That's what John says. It's rhetorical. It's like the obvious answer is it can't. And if the church, if we, and when we speak of the church, it's us, if we are in need and we will not be generous, John is saying, what the heck? If we're in need as a church, as a family of God, John says, and we have money to live, to have a roof over our head and food on the table, and we're not being generous with one another, he's saying, how can God's love be in that person? Which, by the way, let me pause here for just a moment and just say, thank you, Mountain Church, for being such a generous church. And I shared a few weeks ago kind of a situation that we were in, which I think is only fair that we talk about those things always. And in one week, and it was no surprise to me at all, Mountain Church just was like, yeah, oh, we're in, yeah, I'm in. And man, we took care of everything. You know, the lease was paid, everything's taken care of, we're right back on track again. Because Mountain Church is generous like that. The love of God is seen in our giving. And so I just want to say, as a part of Mountain Church, thank you. I love being a part of a church that responds, not just in, I'll pray for you, brother, be warmed and filled. But a church that's like, yeah, we need to ramp it up. Oh, man, well, I'm going to ramp it up. I should be a generous person. Oh, I'm going to be a generous person. And I just want to say, as a part of the body, we should all say this to one another. Thank you to one another. Because that by that, everything's handled. And it always will be. And the Lord's really stirred some things up in my heart that I'll talk to you about in a few weeks. But through this season, the Lord's brought us through. And oftentimes, you know this, when the Lord, a lot of times he'll use finances to get our attention. It's like, Jim, you are so dull. The only way I seem to really get your attention is just to like ring some things out, you know? And it's like, whoa, wow, yeah, when it comes to finances, you got my attention, Lord. Never are my prayers more sincere than right now. And, you know, I'm just like, you know, you got my attention. And then it has nothing to do with that. It has to do with something else over here. And one of those things was just separating again and prioritizing exclusively the table of the Lord. We'll talk about some other things. My wife and I are taking a few weeks off starting as soon as you leave today. So I should wrap this up. And we're going to be celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary. That, all glory to God and all incredible love from my wife. She's a saint. That she would stay with me for 3 years is a miracle. 30 is a miracle upon miracles. And but the Lord's really impressed some things on myself and others that I look forward to sharing with you when I get back. But back to what we were sharing earlier, is one of the things the Lord got my attention on, and among other things, was, man, always having the table of the Lord as the centerpiece of my life and our life. Because if we don't walk in forgiveness, man, we can't walk at all. And if we don't walk in love, what are we doing? And that's the beauty of the table, is knowing that we're forgiven. And so we're going to worship the Lord in that way again right now. We're going to come to his table. And so let's pause and pray, and then we'll come to the table of the Lord. Lord, we thank you for loving us like you do. And we thank you for your word that is so straight up. It just is so not misinterpreted. It's just black and white. There's no room for alternate ideas. It's just truth. And Lord, we want to be a people identified by love. And Lord, if your word is spoken today and we're like, man, I don't have love in my heart, something's wrong, then this is your moment of salvation. This is your moment to place your faith in Christ and to know that your sins are forgiven. And we welcome you to come to the table and just receive Christ and receive his body and blood and his forgiveness for you. And Lord, for those of us that do know you, we just come and celebrate. This is a time to dance and a time to sing and a time to confess, but also a time to rejoice and just say, Lord, thank you that we are forgiven. Thank you that your blood cleanses us. And so, Lord, we just bless you and we love you. We're so thankful that we can worship you. We're so thankful that we can be free people. And if there's people that you've placed in our heart that we've held bitterness towards, Lord, I know that by your Spirit, you're not going to let that go. You're going to force our hand because you love us so much to work out this love with those individuals. Get that stuff out of our heart. Get that bitter seed out. And so, Lord, thank you for loving us and dying for us. We just come to your table to celebrate you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The tables are open in the back and down front. Come and take the elements of communion, and feel free to find a quiet place to sit, or you can come down here and whatever, and then we'll all have communion together in just a moment.
darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. Sing, you give life. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Sing all the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Your hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Sing, great are you, Lord. Great are you,
Lord, words are so inadequate. It's the best we can do. Singing out these songs, but Lord, our life is what we give. Because you you gave yours, Lord, and we just thank you. And we take this bread and do what you've instructed us to remember you, that it's by your body and the brokenness of it, Lord, that we've been healed. By your stripes, been healed of the sickness and the disease, the addiction to sin. It has no power in our life. It's been broken because you were broken. And we take this bread, Lord, in remembrance of you, in Jesus' name. Let's take the bread together. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, nothing is more precious. Nothing has greater value than the blood of Christ. For by it, Lord, we are forgiven. By the blood of the Lamb, we are in perfect standing. By the blood of the Lamb, we've been given life. By the blood of the Lamb, our sins are cast from the east to the west and not remembered. By the blood of the Lamb, we boldly come into your throne room of grace. By the blood of the Lamb, we're family, adopted as your very own. And that's who we are. And it's all because of the blood. And so we praise you and we bless you and we celebrate you and we give thanks in remembrance of you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Let's take the cup together. Thank you, Lord. Lord, hear our songs of praise as we just sing out to you in these next few moments, Lord, just celebrating you, blessing you as your Spirit speaks to us, Lord. We want to respond because, Lord, we want to be changed more and more into a people of love. So you be blessed, you be honored in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're just going to continue to worship here for another couple of songs. I encourage you to stick around, and Tom will dismiss us here in a few moments.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love. For me, not again. against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. And I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me.
Today with this new song called Great Things. It's a newer song by Phil Wickham, and let's just sing it in with each other. But first, let us just pray real quick. Father, thank you, God, for just that truth that we are your children. God, and you do discipline those you love. Although that might not be a fun experience, Lord, today's word was that for me, just a reminder that, Lord, if I'm not loving, then this is just pointless. I'm not representing you. And so, Lord, I pray that this church would be overflowing with love, that it would show on our body language, that it would show on our words. God, that we would just be a people that represent you with joy. So be in this place as we sing this new song. You ready? Here we go. Oh, hero of heaven, God bless you guys. Thanks for coming to church today. We'll see you around.
Hey, thanks for joining us today online and taking in the word with us and worshiping with us. My name is Pastor Jim here at Mountain Church. And I know you were totally blessed by the word, but I'd love to have the opportunity to meet you. And so if you can make it down to any of our weekend services, we'd love to pray with you, love to get to know you and help you get connected. So if you need more information, check out mtnchurch.tv, and most of our information is posted there. God bless you guys, and I look forward to seeing you soon.